Prostate cancer is the number one cancer that afflicts men, so it's a malignancy. While nobody really knows how it develops, we know that certain populations are at an increased risk of it. So it is thought to be a disease of aging men, although young men can still get it and can have aggressive forms of it as well. There are other populations like African-American men, and then men who have a first-degree relative with prostate cancer. So prostate cancer is usually diagnosed through a blood test called the prostate-specific antigen, commonly known as PSA. It can also be diagnosed through a digital rectal exam that's done by a physician. Not everybody who has an elevated PSA has prostate cancer, and there's really not a very good cutoff for a PSA level that would alarm someone. Sometimes it's just an overall elevation in the number, sometimes it's the rate of change of the PSA, and different individuals can have different levels of PSA, say based on their age or based on the size of the prostate. So it's really a nuanced discussion with your physician when you do have a PSA test to then uncover the cancer, which is ultimately diagnosed through a procedure called a biopsy. So there's a multitude of treatment options for prostate cancer. The standard treatment options would be active surveillance, and this would be usually for an early cancer, usually for a cancer that we believe is not likely to affect you during your lifetime. And active surveillance would mean that we would watch the cancer closely, not forget about it, and if there's any signs of progression, we can then intervene. And this way we balance the risk of the cancer, which is hopefully minimal if we're watching it, versus the risk of any complications from treatment. The other two treatments that we would talk about would be radiation therapy and surgery, which is removal of the prostate, also known as a radical prostatectomy. Radical prostatectomy can be performed using a robotic tool, so it could be a robotic prostatectomy, or it can be the conventional open prostatectomy. Open prostatectomy is done via an open incision or an incision that goes below the patient's navel, whereas the robotic approach is performed through multiple tiny incisions, and the robotic instruments go through those incisions and are still controlled by the surgeon to perform the operation. There are many good reasons to come to Johns Hopkins for your robotic prostatectomy procedure. I think to step back, you should come to Johns Hopkins for prostate cancer because we are really a center of excellence for prostate cancer, and we've been a center for of excellence for many, many years. Many of the seminal discoveries in the world of prostatectomy happened here. The first radical prostatectomy happened at Johns Hopkins in 1904. In the 1980s, Dr. Patrick Walsh, who was a Johns Hopkins urologist and the director of urology at the time, discovered the neurovascular bundles, which are the nerve bundles that everybody aims to spare during surgery to protect erectile function after the procedure. Beyond the history, however, we've been able to refine our knowledge of prostatectomy and perfect it, and we have a well-versed and experienced team that has performed thousands of radical prostatectomies that will take care of you here. So the care team for our prostate cancer patient would depend on the stage of the disease. So for somebody with more aggressive cancer, we may include a radiation oncologist and a medical oncologist. But for somebody with the average prostate cancer who is having a radical prostatectomy, our care team would include an anesthesiologist who's experienced in robotic surgery. There are some nuances to the anesthesia that that needs to be taken into account. We also have a dedicated nursing team that is really very experienced in robotic surgery and has taught other teams really how to be adept at robotic surgery. And of course, there's the surgeon as well. We also work with a nurse navigator who helps the patient navigate through the system to get to the radical prostatectomy and help optimize their recovery. So recovery after prostatectomy, most patients are in the hospital for one night, and you will have a catheter that sits in the bladder, that sits there and for about 7 to 10 days. The catheter is there to bridge the new connection between the urethra and the bladder where the prostate used to be. That catheter comes out and then you start on the way to recovery. Some patients will go back to work immediately after the catheter is removed, and some will wait another anywhere between 1 to 2 weeks after that to regain their full strength. That sometimes depends on baseline health characteristics and the type of disease that they had. Yeah, so my recommendations for anyone diagnosed with prostate cancer is, number one, take a deep breath. Things are going to be fine. Luckily, we've come a long way in prostate cancer care. The first is to have a positive outlook. I think that for most patients, luckily today, that is true. Number two is to do your research and go to a place to get care where the institution is renowned for prostate cancer and the individual doctors are also renowned for prostate cancer, and ask a lot of questions.